Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Burning for Revenge, written by John Marsden and read by Suzi Dougherty. Be sure to visit our website on www.belinda.com. Details of other available and forthcoming Belinda audiobook releases can be found at the end of this recording. And now here's your narrator, Suzi Dougherty, with Burning for Revenge.
The book begins with a dedication. To my sister Louise Marsden, with much love. Acknowledgements. Many thanks to Charlotte and Rick Lindsay, Rachel Angus, Mary Edmonston, Miss Ed, Paul Kenny, Catherine Proctor, and Helen Kent. Chapter 1. The summer storms are the wildest. Maybe that's because they're so unexpected, but they can really rip a place apart. It's like the sky saves it all up, then lets it go in one huge blast. The air shakes. There's nothing soft or gentle about the rain. It pours down, a huge, heavy torrent that wets you to the skin in half a minute. The thunder's so close and loud you can feel it all around you, like a landslide or an avalanche. And sometimes there's hail. Before the war, I found summer storms exciting. I enjoyed the noise and the violence and the out-of-control wildness, even though I knew there'd be problems afterwards. Trees blown down or struck by lightning, fresh-shorn sheep getting dangerously cold, creeks flooding. Occasionally, the problems came during the storms. One time, I had to go out in massive rain to move a small mob of ewes because a falling tree brought down their fence and the rams were getting horny. I started moving the mob, but Millie, the dog, got a bit excited, and when one sheep went the wrong way, she chased it straight into the creek. The creek was running at a million k's an hour, about to break its banks. The water was just beginning to lap over on both sides. The ewe and the dog, both paddling like mad, got swept away. I ran along the bank, trying to find a spot where I could jump in and pull them out. To be honest, I didn't think they had much hope. But a kilometre down the paddock, they were washed up on a gravel spit. The ewe staggered out, half-drowned. Millie staggered out, half-drowned too. She didn't hesitate. She went straight after that sheep again, chasing it back to the mob. Poor sheep. There are times when I feel quite sorry for sheep. Another time, we were out at the Mackenzies when a big storm hit. We got home to find a sheet of galvanized iron had come loose on the shearing shed. It was flapping in the wind with a sound I'd never forgotten. Like it wanted to beat itself to death. A frantic, desperate, wild noise. When I got up on the ladder, I could see the iron tearing centimeter by centimeter. Solid, indestructible metal being ripped apart by the wind. It was quite scary trying to hammer down this crazed, thrashing thing in the dark. Here, in this place I've learnt to call home, a summer storm is dramatic. In the Bible it says hell is a place of heat and fire. This is officially called hell. That's the name on the maps, and it does get hot in summer. But when a storm drops on top of us, it's hypothermia country and the temperature can fall 15 degrees in half an hour. Of course, if life had gone the way it was meant to, I wouldn't be sitting in a little tent in hell, watching the fabric stretch and pull, watching the rain chuck a tantrum against the fly, listening to the screech of another branch ripping and falling, and trying to keep writing this record of our lives. I would have been sitting in our snug cabin in New Zealand, eating pizza and reading Pride and Prejudice, or The Horse's Mouth, for the fourth time. Better still, I would have been back at my real home, checking the water troughs in the paddock, or yabbing in a dam, or cutting the poor breeders out of a mob of cattle to send to market. Well, none of those things would happen for a while yet. They might never happen again. I just had to accept that. But it didn't stop me playing the old useless game of if only. If only our country hadn't been invaded. If only we could have carried on the way we used to, watching other people's wars on television. If only we'd been better prepared and thought more about this stuff. Then later, when we got ourselves out of the battle zone, if only we hadn't agreed to come back and continue to fight, to help the Kiwi soldiers in their failed attempt at the airbase. Well, we didn't really have much choice about coming back. Colonel Finlay put so much pressure on us, and we put pressure on ourselves. That was another if only. I suppose we would have felt guilty if we hadn't come back. Besides, we had such high hopes of meeting up with our parents again. If only we could have all been as lucky as Fee. She at least got to see her parents for half an hour. I was still burning about Colonel Finlay. the helicopter he was meant to send, the helicopter he'd promised us, the way he more or less abandoned us after his Kiwi troops went missing, the way that when we called up and asked for the chopper, suddenly they were too busy. For a dozen crack New Zealand troops, we knew there'd have been no problem. But for us, that was a major problem. The joke was that we'd achieved more with our rough-and-ready tactics, our homemade bombs and make-it-up-as-you-go approach, than just about any professional soldier could have done. We thought so anyway. And when we were in New Zealand, enough people were ready to tell us that. Only now that we were back here, trapped in lonely, wild hell, they seemed happy to forget us. If only the chopper had turned up and whisked us back to safety. I wanted it to be like a taxi. Just dial a number. Where are you going? How many passengers? What name? We'll have it there in no time, love. No worries. It was hard not to be bitter. We felt like Colonel Finlay had dumped us. We talked about it non-stop for a week, till we got sick of it as a topic for conversation and agreed not to talk about it anymore. That was the only way we could stop it poisoning us. After we'd finished our week or so of sulking, we started getting restless. Lee was the worst. Since he found out about the death of his parents, he was burning for action. When I say action, I don't necessarily mean revenge, although I'm sure he was keen on that. But I think he could have been distracted from thoughts of revenge if there'd been other things to think about, other things to do. There was nothing. We'd built a few odds and ends in hell, the chook shed mainly, but we couldn't build anything else new because it was too dangerous. There was such a risk of being seen from the air, or even from the top of Taylor's Stitch, the ridge that wound far above us, the west wall of our hideout. Lee didn't seem interested in reading the few books we'd brought. He didn't have his precious music with him, and he wasn't in the mood for talking. All he had were his thoughts. He sat alone for hours every day and wouldn't even tell me what he was thinking. Homer and Kevin weren't any better. One afternoon, they spent 4 hours trying to hit a tree trunk with pebbles. They sat on the bank of the creek and chucked stones at the tree until they ran out of ammo. Then they went over and picked up the pebbles and started again. By the end of the afternoon, Homer hit it 6 times and Kevin 3. Fair enough, it was 50 meters away, but I thought they could have done better. I thought I could have done better. That wasn't what bothered me, though. It was their mood. They seemed so flat, so uninterested. I nearly suggested going out and attacking the enemy again just to get them motivated. As it happened, I didn't need to suggest that. Almost at the same moment as I thought it, well, less than half an hour later, Lee suddenly turned to me and said, "I'm leaving here. Going to Wirrawee or somewhere. Cobblers Bay, maybe. Stratton, even. I'm not going to spend the rest of the war sitting around waiting to be rescued. I want to do as much damage as I can." My breath went. I knew I couldn't stop him. In some ways, I didn't want to stop him. In other ways, I did. I was deeply in like with Lee. Maybe even love. I wasn't sure about that. Sometimes it definitely felt like love. Other times, I didn't want anything to do with him. When it came to Lee, I felt the full range of emotions, from wild passion to revulsion. On the average, I think I was in like with him. But it wasn't just Lee that I wasn't sure about. It was everything. Maybe it's just a teenage thing, not being sure about stuff. I wasn't sure if there was a God, if there was life after death. I wasn't sure if I'd ever see my parents again, if Lee and I should have made love, if we'd been acting the right way since the invasion, if the sun would rise in the morning or set at night. I wasn't sure if I liked eggs, hard-boiled or soft. So Lee saying calmly and strongly that he was going out to continue the fight. How could I tell him he was doing the wrong thing? I was less sure about that than I was about the sun rising. We were sitting quite a way up the track, on the last flat bit, at the point where it started to climb to Wombogonu. For a long time, neither of us spoke. I knew what a big statement he'd made. I knew we were approaching the end of our short rest. We both knew we might be approaching the end of our short lives. Death might be sneaking up on us both right now. Because I knew, of course, that I couldn't let Lee go out there on his own. I think we both felt that none of us, none of our group of five, would let Lee go alone. In a way, I should have resented him putting us under this kind of pressure, not giving me or the others a real choice. He'd done it to us before, and I hadn't liked it. I didn't like anyone putting me under pressure, telling me what to do, making decisions for me. I remember going off my head when Homer announced we were coming back from New Zealand in the first place. If it was different this time, perhaps it was because I knew things were getting too desperate. The war was at such a critical stage and our help was needed like never before. We simply couldn't lounge around having long rests between gigs. When we talked to the others, I found things were a bit more complicated than I expected. Homer and Fee reacted like I thought they would, pretty much the same as me. But Kevin? Well, I hadn't let myself think that any of us might go off like he did. How could I? If I did, I might have to think about my own fears. Those fears had sent me into a panic when Colonel Finlay said he wanted us to come back from New Zealand. Those fears had taken control of me completely when the enemy soldier walked towards me in the streets of Werriwee. Those fears caused a scream to come ripping out of my throat when silence was the only option. For all I knew, my scream might have caused the capture or death of the 12 New Zealand guerrillas. So I couldn't think about Kevin not being as brave as me. I couldn't condemn him for lacking a bit of gut sometimes. It happened while we were at the fireplace, eating a lunch that was mainly rice, like a lot of our meals these days. Lee started making his big announcement, but he'd hardly finished his first sentence when Homer burst out, "We might as well go and do something. This is hopeless, sitting around here. Even if we do some tiny little thing, it'd be better than this." "Danger's a drug," I thought as I sat there watching him, "and you're hooked on it, Homer." "I don't mind doing little things," Fee said. "I just hope you guys can stop at little things. But you never seem satisfied with that. You always want to go for the big blast." Kevin said nothing for a minute. Then, with voice shaking, he said, "I don't think we should do any more. The way Finley's dumped us here, it sucks. Why should we do anything for him? He sold us right down the creek." No one seemed to know how to answer that. I mean, I think we did know. It's just that no one wanted to be the one to do it. We weren't too keen on flowery, patriotic speeches. For some stupid reason, I opened my mouth, though. I had no right to, but I did. "Kevin, this isn't anything to do with Colonel Finlay. We've all said about 1,000 times what we think of him not sending the chopper. That's not the issue. The main thing is that we're in a position to do something to help, and no one else can. I don't think we've got much choice." Then I said the stupid thing. The unforgivable thing. "I know we're all scared, Kevin, but we've just got to go out there and do it." There were some things we never said to each other, and the word scared was one of them. Oh, maybe at night in our sleeping bags when we were being honest, when we couldn't see each other's faces. But this wasn't one of those times. Kevin went red, and even Fee, sitting beside me, drew away a little. "At least I don't scream when I see a soldier," Kevin said. He got up and walked off. I sat there burning with shame and fury. I knew why he'd said it. Even in my rage, I knew why he said it. But I didn't know if I could ever forgive him. I had enough trouble forgiving myself. Homer said, "That wasn't very smart, Ellie."
"I'll leave her alone," Fee said.
Lee didn't say anything. That hurt too. I thought he would have stuck up for me, especially against Kevin, who he didn't like much. So that was why I was lying in my tent listening to the summer storm smashing into the bush, watching the thrashing and threshing of the tent, crying out in fear as a small branch landed on the nylon fly. The thunder boomed and blasted. The rain had never fallen more heavily, and I never felt more alone in my life. Chapter 2. We were all paralyzed by the tension between Kevin and me. I thought it would blow over in an hour or two like most of our arguments, like the summer storms. But Kevin wouldn't talk to me, and no matter how keen the others were to get out of hell, they didn't seem to be able to make a move while this coldness went on. I tried to apologize to Kevin, but he wouldn't listen. That made me feel I was definitely in the right now, which didn't help settle things, as it made me less interested in trying again. On the third day, though, Lee settled it, in a kind of way, by saying suddenly and aggressively, "Look, I said to Ellie the other day that I was going, whether anyone else came or not. I should have gone then, when I said I was. So the hell with the lot of you. I'm going now."
"I'll come," Homer said straight away.
"So will I," Fee said.
"I will if you want me," I said.
"Of course I bloody want you,"
Lee said, looking irritated. No one looked at Kevin, who was trying to clean a frying pan that had some burnt rice stuck to it. I don't know what recipe he'd used for his fried rice, but it hadn't worked too well. His face was red, but probably not from the sweat he put into his scrubbing. He didn't say anything for so long that we gave up and assumed he wasn't going to speak at all. Instead, we just started talking about what we needed to take with us. Suddenly, Kevin interrupted.
"You could at least include me in this," he grumbled.
We looked at each other.
This time I wasn't going to be the one to say something. No one else seemed in a hurry either. Finally, Fee, the peacemaker, said,
"Well, we weren't sure if you wanted to come."
"Of course I'm coming," Kevin snapped. "Would you think I was going to stay here on my own? I'm not that stupid. You saw what happened to Chris."
There was another pause. Then we kept going with our plans, with Kevin making the occasional comment, usually negative. For once, though, we didn't have many plans. I didn't like that. Normally, we gave a lot of thought to what we were doing. The longer the war lasted, the more we seemed to make things up as we went along. It made me feel insecure. There was only one thing I wanted, and that was to go in the direction of Holloway, to look for my mother. The others had no particular objection to that. Homer's parents were thought to be somewhere near Stratton, and we didn't want to go that way. The country there was too built up, too closely settled. It seemed too dangerous for us.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.